people. Why is it
not the greatest country in the world, Professor? That's my answer.
You're saying
yes.
Let's talk about
fine. Sharon, the NEA is a loser. Yeah, it accounts for a penny out of our paycheck, but he gets to hit you with it anytime he wants. It doesn't cost money. It costs votes. It costs airtime and column inches. You know why people don't like liberals? Because they lose.
If liberals are so fucking smart, how come they lose so goddamn always?
Hey,
and with a straight face, you're gonna tell students that America is so star-spangled awesome that we're the only ones in the world who have freedom? Canada has freedom. Japan has freedom. The UK, France, Italy, Germany, Spain, Australia, Belgium has freedom. So 207 sovereign states in the world, like 180 of them have freedom.
All right.
And yeah, you, sorority girl, just in case you accidentally wander into a voting booth one day, there's some things you should know. And one of them is there is absolutely no evidence to support the statement that we're the greatest country in the world. We're 7th in literacy, 27th in math, 22nd in science, 49th in life expectancy, 178th in infant mortality, 3rd in median household income, number 4 in labor force, and number 4 in exports. We lead the world in only 3 categories: number of incarcerated citizens per capita, number of adults who believe angels are real, and defense spending, where we spend more than the next 26 countries combined, 25 of whom are allies. Now, none of this is the fault of a 20-year-old college student, but you nonetheless are, without a doubt, a member of the worst period, generation, period, ever, period. So when you ask what makes us the greatest country in the world, I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. Yosemite? We cared about our neighbors. We put our money where our mouths were, and we never beat our chest. We built great big things, made ungodly technological advances, explored the universe, cured diseases, and we cultivated the world's greatest artists and the world's greatest economy. We reached for the stars, acted like men. We aspired to intelligence. We didn't belittle it. It didn't make us feel inferior. We didn't identify ourselves by who we voted for in the last election, and we didn't scare so easy. We were able to be all these things and do all these things because we were informed by great men who were revered. First step in solving any problem is recognizing there is one. America is not the greatest country in the world anymore.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. pledge you that we shall neither commit nor provoke aggression, that we shall neither flee nor invoke the threat of force, that we shall never negotiate out of fear, and we shall never fear to negotiate. Terror is not a new weapon. Throughout history, it has been used by those who could not prevail, either by persuasion or example. But inevitably, they fail, either because men are not afraid to die for a life worth living, or because the terrorists themselves came to realize that free men cannot be frightened by threat, and that aggression would be its own response. And it is in the light of that history that every nation today should know, be he friend or foe, that the United States has both the will and the weapons to join free men standing up to their responsibility. Citizens of Berlin, and therefore, as a free man, I take pride in the word, Ich bin ein Berliner. The path we have chosen for the present is full of hazards, as all paths are, but it is the one most consistent with our courage and faith, and our commitment around the world. One path we shall never choose, and that is the path of surrender or submission.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept. One we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and the other to
lose. I believe in America, with a separation of church and state, absolutely.
Where no Catholic prelate would tell the president, should he be Catholic, how to act, and no Protestant minister would tell his parishioners for whom to vote.
When no church or church school is granted any public funds or political preference,
and when no man is denied public office merely because his religion differs from the president who might appoint him, or the people who might elect him.
I have therefore chosen this time and place to discuss the topic of the girl off the wall,
and the truth too rarely received, and that is the most important topic on earth, peace. What kind of a peace do I mean, and what kind of a peace do we see? Not a Pax Americana, enforced on the world by American weapons of war. Not the peace of the grave, or the security of the slaves. I am talking about genuine peace, the kind of peace that makes life on earth worth living, and the kind that enables men and nations to grow and to hope and build a better life for their children. Not merely peace for Americans, but peace for all men and women. Not merely peace in our time, but peace in all time.
We are confronted primarily with a moral issue. It is as old as the scriptures and is as clear as the American Constitution. The heart of the question is whether all Americans are to be afforded equal rights and equal opportunities. Whether we are going to treat our fellow Americans. If an American, because his skin is dark, cannot eat lunch in a restaurant or open in a public school, if he cannot send his children to the best public school available, if he cannot vote for the public officials who represent him, if in short he cannot enjoy the full and free life which all of us want, then who among us would be content to have the color of his skin changed and stand in his place? Who among us would then be content to the counsels of patience and delay? 100 years of delay have passed. President Lincoln freed the slaves
by those